releasing the balloons, and we'll be able to get underway with the really serious stuff at hand. Okay. Now, Tom Brookshire, you've covered a lot of college football bowl games.
Yes.
I know you have a very interesting theory about what matters most here.
Well, the basket coach Tom Osborne told me when you get two teams at this high level, we're talking about two of the unbeaten teams in the country, Miami and Penn State, what they will probably do, Johnson or Paterno, will be take away what the other team does well. If it's stopping Testaverde that Penn State has to do, they'll make them run. The rushing game is a pretty good rushing game, so what you do poorly, you have to do very well in a big game. On the other side, Penn State runs a lot. They're one of the best rushing teams in the country. If they are stopped, can they throw and catch up? And that's going to be the big problem. They can't get too far behind with Schaefer and the Lions having to throw as a steady diet.
So it's almost like saying if you take away the best, if you take away Vinny from Miami
that's
and
right.
the running game from Penn State, then you're matching Miami's running game against Penn State's passing game. And
that's
who shapes up best there?
Well, that's what you don't want to do, is fall far enough behind if you're a Penn State Nittany Lion where you've got to throw the ball all the time. If you can throw it when you want to, it might be different. They might do that.
And
tonight.
There may be the key. John Schaefer at quarterback
that's
again
right.
for the Nittany Lions as he was a year ago. Tom Brookshire in a very important and critical role. And Jackie Hayes, it didn't go so well for John Schaefer a year ago at the Orange Bowl.
Perhaps it didn't go so well a year ago, but you know, John Schaefer is some kind of player. He is an academic All-American. As Lou found out, he is some kind of man.
He is All-American handsome, and his collegiate record is a gaudy 22 wins and just one loss. And for all this, John Schaefer is the Rodney Dangerfield of quarterbacks. Little or no respect for most, because they remember the loss. And the memory still echoes in his own mind.
You know, the first thing I did when I got back to Cincinnati was go downstairs and put the tape of the game in and see what, you know, what really happened. A lot of things that were said were untrue. Some were true. Most weren't.
It was a young Penn State team that night, playing for the national championship perhaps a year ahead of schedule, and they went away from their usual style. And John Schaefer will never challenge Vinny Testaverde in the passing department.
In the Orange Bowl, that wasn't his fault. I think Joe should have pulled him out a lot earlier than he did, and this would have never happened.
Lesser men might have caved in right there, but John Schaefer instead is back for that rare second chance for redemption.
It's the biggest game of my career to this point. And who knows how many football games we may play or I may play after this game. You know, it's a big football game. It's the biggest. There's nothing more that you can really say about the game other than we're going to have to be at our best to be able to be fortunate enough to win the football game.
A favorite target in the short passing game this year is number 32 Blair Thomas, Philadelphia's Frankfort High. He and others will tell you that Schaefer means much, much more to the Nittany Lions than just a solid throwing arm.
Well, he's our leader. You know, when I walk out of that squad after he gives a speech, I'm ready to play. You know, right there.
Whatever situation is that we're in, that he can get us out of it somehow, because we have a lot of belief in him. And he's come through for us so many times in the clutch, and we expect no different from him Friday.
Comparing it to last year, I feel much more comfortable than this situation last year. And we all know what happened last year.
22-0 in the regular season, 0-1 in the national championship, but a second chance tonight. I'm sorry, Jackie. I was going to say, obviously a poised young man for a very well-to-do family.
That's right, and some of his own pep squad with me right now, John Schaefer's mother, Jan Schaefer, brother, and aunt and uncle, is that right, from Philadelphia?
Right.
You've got to be very, very proud right now.
We are extremely proud, as always.
Are you a little bit nervous?
Yes, I would be lying if I said that I were not nervous.
What does it take to, he's not only a good athlete, but he's a good student, perhaps has a big career as a financial analyst. What goes into making an all-round good kid?
The first thing, being a financial analyst, he's always been very tight with his money, and he has spent it wisely. Secondly, from the time John was just a youngster, he has been extremely self-disciplined, very dedicated, and whatever he set out to do, whatever was his goal, he set forth and tried to achieve it.
How do you help him deal with the ups and downs? I mean, there has to be. After the Orange Bowl last year, how do you as parents help?
We listen when he wants to talk. We try to support when we feel that he needs it. He has an awful lot of love from the whole family that stretches from California to Maine.
That's terrific. And good luck to you guys. We'll all be pulling for John Schaefer and the Nittany Lions tonight. Thank you very much.
All right, John Schaefer on one side of the football for Penn State at quarterback, but of course the big story is that guy on the other side, Big Vinny Testaverde, the Heisman Trophy winner. You'll meet him next as Fiesta Bowl preview continues. Through the Pass joins us now live. Todd Blackledge joining us now. Tom Brookshire, and boy, this guy can do it, huh?
Well, the people of Penn State fans were yelling up there, but remember 82, which was, of course, the 83, the big one. Joe Paterno has a way of taking away something the other team. He took away Marcus Allen the time when you guys were down here and won the Fiesta Bowl over SC. He did it with Herschel Walker. Can he possibly take Testaverde away without really putting the defense in jeopardy, do you think, Todd?
Well, I don't know if you can take Vinny Testaverde out of the football game. One thing I do know, if you give a Joe Paterno coach team a couple weeks to prepare for one particular team and one offense, they're going to come out and play a good football game. And so I think you'll see Testaverde get some plays tonight, but they're going to try to frustrate him and confuse him a little bit and hopefully make him force the ball a little bit.
Sometimes it's not the best thing just to try to run him around. I somehow feel like he's better when he's almost flushed out and throws the ball on the run after secondary people have sort of forgotten their receivers.
Well, that's another threat that he provides, and I think it's another weapon that he is, his ability to move in the pocket and throw on the run, so they'll have to be aware of that.
Now, you're the quarterback for the Kansas City Chiefs. Can the Penn State team do enough on the ground to where Vinny spends most of the time sitting and watching? Is that the best way to stop him?
I think they'll have to do it that way. I think that they're going to have to rely on their defense playing good, but their offense is going to have to control the football and keep him off the field.
All right, Todd. Thanks a million.
All right, thank you.
Nice to see you, Todd.
All right.
Well, Tom Brookshire, the whole thing here, really, there's a lot of money to be made for the first time ever.
Yep.
Over $2 million.
$2.4 million.
Yeah, to the winner, but to both teams here in the Fiesta Bowl. Now joining us live, Jackie Hayes with Eyewitness News, Walt Hunter.
That's right. We've had the pleasure of working together all week. Walt, you've been sort of covering a little bit of football, a little bit of fans, a little bit of money.
Jackie, it's been a wonderful week out here. Not only the weather, but a lot of money involved. Of course, you know, all the teams here tonight, both of them are winners. But the Fiesta Bowl itself, well, it wasn't always a winner. It took quite a bit of effort to turn the Fiesta Bowl into what officials are now calling the game of the century.
Say that the fans are already part of a big victory. They are experiencing nothing less than the rebirth of a bowl game. This year, the Fiesta is a big winner. In Tempe, Arizona, Walt Hunter, Channel 3 Eyewitness News.
On more ways than one, I was to the Orange Bowl last year. We've talked about that all during the week when Penn State had the chance to play for the national championship there. And I've rarely seen a community, and this isn't to stroke them any, but they've really embraced the folks who have come into town here.
That's right. They're saying some $25 million brought in by the fans coming here, and you multiply that three times over and the after effects and how it trickles in. That's a whole bunch of money. Why don't we take a look at look at the whole bunch of people right now. A lot of folks here from Penn State, a lot of very happy fans, glad to be here, Penn State pride.
You're going
to
see them right now. There they are. We are Penn State, as they're rallying cry just behind our broadcast location right here, Jackie Hayes. And this is as pumped up and as loud, we talked about Penn State style earlier, as I've ever seen the Nittany Lions. And just judging from what I've seen from their players this week, I really do anticipate a special night.
You bet. You saw them at the Fiesta Bowl parade. It turned into an impromptu pep rally for Penn State, and we have a whole lot more coverage coming up on our Fiesta Bowl preview. Stay with us.
Was a very memorable time. The Heisman was important for a lot of reasons. It was important to us, to our family, for certain, you know, personal reasons, and it was important to the school, I think, because it was the first time it had been done.
It's been 13 years, but Cappelletti remembers his Heisman dinner as if it were yesterday.
There were certain things that I wanted to say that were inside of me. The one thing that I really felt sensitive about and close to, that, and I really wanted to do it, was the fact that I, you know, presented the trophy to my brother.
The youngest member of my family, Joseph, is very ill. He has leukemia. And if I could dedicate this trophy to him tonight and give him a couple days of happiness, this is worth everything.
What happened to him, he really wasn't the one that was worried or down or, you know, feel sorry for himself. You know, he just would have liked to have lived normally, I'm sure, like anybody else, but he didn't question it. Just the fact that he was my brother, was more important than anything.
The Heisman Trophy was John Cappelletti's gift to his brother. Their love was his gift to us all. This is Ray Dittinger for Eyewitness Sports.
A story that you really can't tell or hear too often at all. And John Cappelletti, nice to see you. You're still looking good. But you still have the wheels, Brookshire asked you a minute ago. Huh?
All that happened, but most of them I do, yeah. I got out of it pretty good, so I can't really complain for the years that I played.
I remember we gave him the Maxwell Trophy in Philadelphia. It's, of course, a Heisman Award, if you will. And then he went into Pro Bowl, and I did a lot of coverage of you with the Rams. What about Dozier and the Penn State runners, Smith and Manoa, on the grass? Are they going to be better rushing the football on this kind of a natural turf?
I think they will. I think hopefully it'll slow down Miami's attack a little bit. The field looks firm enough, but I don't think it's going to have much effect one way or the other.
John, Shane Conlon had a comment. He said, I can't wait to get these guys out on the football field, and we're going to show them how the big boys play football. Is intimidation a factor, do you think, in a game like this?
I think Miami tried it, to be honest with you, right from the beginning, but I don't think it worked very well. And comments like that from Shane kind of counterbalance all that. And I think the frustration of the last couple of weeks will come out in about the first 5 or 10 minutes, and then they'll all settle down and play a good ball game.
I have a feeling that Alonzo Highsmith on the other side and Bratton are two good running backs, and they may be sort of auditioning for the pros, and they may really put on a pretty good rushing game. I have a feeling they're better than we think they are running the ball.
Right. One thing I think they have to do is stop their running game right away, because then it will make it more predictable than they're going to go.
All right.
John, I'm just hooking up with the folks back there at Penn State. Your dad's here with you tonight. You get butterflies when your boys go out there on the field?
Yeah, I don't even know if you had to play it one time to get butterflies. Hey, this is pretty exciting. This is really enjoyable, and looking forward to it.
That's terrific. It's going to be a lot of fun.
Come on, let's go. Prediction, what do you think?
Oh, Penn State.
What a surprise.
No, I think for a lot of reasons, if they play their kind of ball game and they don't get into situations where a field position determines a lot right away, I think they'll be in the ball game right away.
John, you're looking good. All your friends and family from back in Philadelphia, I'm sure, wishing you well in the Nittany Lions tonight.
Thank you.
Jackie, more to come, huh?
That's right. A lot more to come. You can hear the pregame getting started. We've got more coverage coming up. Stay with us.
About as the Penn State Blue Band comes flying out onto the field right now. We're getting ready to do a little flying of our own. We've been here all week, of course, since we flew out from Philadelphia, and the University of Miami team, from the moment that they flew into the Arizona area here, have been nothing but a bunch of characters.
They're different.
The gorilla outfits, yes, at the beginning of the week, and the fatigues and what have you, but they fit into the Wild West motif just about perfect. Well, talk about characters and color. There you have the big blue marching band from the Nittany Mountains of Pennsylvania. That is a sight, Ever.
That's right. You know, attention does mount as game time nears. You can almost feel it in the stadium right now. It'll be 73,000 in here.
I went through this lecture with Jackie the other day, but this was always my favorite part of the football game when the band came out to play.
It certainly does build your spirit, and I think when the Penn State Blue Band went out on the field, if you had an applause meter, Penn State's already won it.
You see, but for Penn State, it gets better, and at Wake Forest, after the band was done playing, it was all downhill after that. Ladies and gentlemen, it is time to put you all on the spot, and Tom Brookshire, to start it off, summarize the Fiesta Bowl and finish with a prediction.
Well, Miami hasn't had a trouble in their 11 ball games. They have a margin of 21 points between scoring and allowing points. Penn State has had trouble in three or four games, barely won them, barely beat Notre Dame, barely beat Cincinnati. And I think for that reason, if they don't get out of it early, if they don't get discouraged, and Penn State has the experience of coming back and winning late, I think Penn State will win the football game. Miami hasn't been behind and Traylon had trouble, and I think tonight they will with this Penn State defense.
All right, Brookshire likes Penn State. Real quickly, Yuki Washington back at the station. What do you think, buddy?
Well, Lou, I'm going to stir up a little bit of controversy back here on the home front. I'm going to have to go with the Miami Hurricanes as my sentimental favorite, simply because when I worked in Fort Myers, I followed the career of two players who played in Fort Myers as high scorers, and now they're Miami Hurricanes, Don Ellis and Warren Williams, and I'd like to see them win a national championship. So I'll stir up the air just a little bit back here at home and say the Miami Hurricanes.
Thank you. We're about to be assaulted. Jackie Hayes, real quick.
No good answers. I just like Penn State. I'm going to go for Penn State.
And this guy likes you, too. And I'm going to balance it out. I'm going to take the Miami Hurricanes 30-23, because Tommy, like you said, if Miami gets out of the gate in a hurry, I don't think you can stop them. And I saw that Pitt-Penn State game, and I like the way Pitt threw the ball underneath. So
I think the key is in the Miami linebacking core and how they handle the shortstop.
I think this is a place and time for Penn State football. I believe they're going to win the football game 27-23.
I say 30-23 Miami. And Jackie,
this is their year, Penn State.
The big blue and white.
That's right.
I might have to agree with you guys, or else we're going to get gored by one of these big poles sitting on here. We're about ready to say goodbye. We've enjoyed our week here in Phoenix, Arizona. I think that's safe to say from all of us.
Yeah, two great teams and two great schools are here.
Closing thought, Jackie?
Great ball game coming up. Stay tuned.
Nicky Washington, Walt Hunter, Jackie Hayes, Tom Brookshire, and Lou Tilley getting ready to send it up to our friends at from NBC.
Almost
blew the whole thing there, folks. Bob Costas, along with the broadcast crew, they'll be along next to bring you the 1987 Fiesta Bowl. It has been our pleasure, and a happy new year to you all.
Happy new year.
Bye-bye now.
Nothing like live television.
Vice. The following is a presentation of NBC Sports, proud to be the network of the 1988 Summer Olympic Games.
A year ago at the Orange Bowl, a national title is within Joe Paterno's grasp, but it's not to be. Oklahoma rides off with a 25-10 win. That same night in New Orleans, the Sugar Bowl, Vinny Testaverde sacked 8 times, 3 interceptions, 3 fumbles, Tennessee 35. Miami 7. Those disappointments are placed aside as the sun rises on a new season. In the next 4 months, all the contenders will be tested. Only 2 will run the gauntlet without a loss. In the season's first showcase, Testaverde throws 4 touchdown passes. Miami 28, Oklahoma 16. The Hurricanes replace the Sooners atop the polls. Alabama will move up to second, but a month later at Tuscaloosa, Penn State snaps the Crimson Tide's 13-game winning streak. The same day, the picture crystallizes further as Colorado upsets third-ranked Nebraska, the Cornhuskers' first loss. Later, Michigan is ranked number 2, standing between Miami and Penn State, but the Wolverines lose at home to Minnesota. 7 days later, Penn State crushes Pitt. The Nittany Lions are 11-0. Then on Thanksgiving night, Jimmy Johnson is without his starting quarterback. With Testaverde sidelined, Johnson turns to senior reserve Jeff Toretta. The Hurricanes top East Carolina and go to 11-0. Only Miami and Penn State greet the new year with a chance to be number 1. Two separate paths, one destination. The steps along the way to a showdown. As the sun sets on this college football season, all that remains is one game for the national title. NBC Sports presents the College Football National Championship. The Miami Hurricanes meet the Penn State Nittany Lions in the Sunkissed Fiesta Bowl. The ultimate game of this college football season will be played on a gorgeous night in the Valley of the Sun. As game time approaches, it's 60 degrees at Sun Devil Stadium in Tempe, Arizona. And we're just moments away from a meeting between two 11-0 teams ranked first and second in the country. An even dozen victories will make one of them the national champion. Good evening and a belated Happy New Year, everybody. I'm Bob Costas. We welcome you to a special game played under special circumstances. The 4 annual games, usually thought of as the major bowls, were unable to create a championship matchup this year. The Rose, Orange, Cotton, and Sugar all have commitments to various conference champions. They couldn't bring this pair of football independents together. But the Sunkissed Fiesta Bowl, anxious to increase its own prestige, could. So they sweetened the pot for Penn State and Miami. NBC moved the game from New Year's Day to primetime the next night, and a unique college football showcase has been created. It's certain to be one of the most watched college games of all time. To help us cover it, Ahmad Rashad is down on the sidelines with some opening thoughts.
Bob, you know, for a college player to play in a bowl game is a dream, but to play in a game that determines the national championship is the ultimate. Now, you would think that with all this hype and hoopla around here all week, that it would put a lot of pressure on the players. Well, I've seen some of these players during the course of the week, and I guarantee you, both teams are very loose, and the credit has to go to the coaches. Now, in the last couple of days, you've seen a lot of bowl games, and you see a lot of players mugging to the camera going, "We're number one." That's out the window. The battle for number one is tonight. And at the end of this game, the players on one of these two teams will be able to look into that camera and say in all sincerity, "We're number one," and mean it.
3, 2, 1, Penn State National Champions! What a tribute to this football team. What a tribute to his coach.
The 1986 Heisman Trophy winner is, from the University of Miami and Long Island, Vinny Testaverde.
A 60-year-old coaching legend, a fixture at his university, and a 23-year-old skyrocket of a player bound for the pros. Yet they have a few things in common, these two. Each was born in Brooklyn. Like Paterno, Testaverde was reared in a strong Italian-American family. As Vinny passed the Hurricanes to the nation's number one ranking and himself to the Heisman Trophy, football fans caught many glimpses of Al and Josie Testaverde sharing a season of emotion with their son.
The biggest influence has been my family and my parents. They've always been behind me whenever I needed them and whatever I did. And especially with football, you know, they've been always there for me.
My father was a great guy. He had more of an influence on me than anything.
How much of your career did your father live to see?
Well, he died in 1955. I was just getting started. I'd been 4 or 5 years assistant coach. He didn't really. He kept waiting for me to get out of it and go on to something. You know, it was meaningful, like law school. So he had a great love for the law, worked in the courts for years as a clerk, and always envisioned, you know, the great lawyer's son. And I was going to do all the things he didn't have time to do. So he never really was crazy about my coach.
But Papa Paterno couldn't have scoffed at this. Joe has headed fundraising drives which have brought millions of dollars to his school's academic programs. And his personal donations have run into the hundreds of thousands. And better than 80% of Joe Paterno's players have graduated.
I think a good coach has got to stand for something. And how he can get what he stands for across to people who depend. Some need a friend. Some need you as a friend. Some you got to be a little and SOB. You got to be tough. You got to make them do things they don't want to do. So until they refine their character. They learn to go to class. They don't go to class, they don't play. They learn to do things because they've got to do them in order to get something else.
Until Paterno, UCLA's John Wooden was the only coach ever selected as Sports Illustrated Sportsman of the Year. SI was persuaded as much by the values Paterno embodies as by his team's one-loss record.
I'm in awe of it, really. I really am. I think that I'm only the second coach ever to get it is kind of, I went to bed last night thinking about that, and I said, "Hey, relax." My wife used to say, "Look in the mirror," and I'd ask her how many great coaches there are. She'd say, "One less than you think."
I'm not as bad
as that. Me and my career would be that. I was a good, hard-working coach, a decent guy, tried to be a good father and a good husband, and just generally enjoyed doing what he was doing.
So they step into the spotlight again tonight, each in his own way the biggest star on his side of the field. But each with a view of the challenge that goes beyond the marquee.
I like Coach Paterno a lot, and I respect him a great deal, but that will not put me in awe. You know, I followed Penn State ever since I was a young kid, but, you know, I'm out there to play a ball game. And
the problem is not just Vinny Testaverde. There's guys like Highsmith and Perryman and Irwin and Bratton and the whole bit. That's a big league football team in a lot of other places. So I don't really think we can go into this football game saying we're going to stop doing, we're going to win. I think we've got to be awfully careful what we decide to do.
And there is Paterno's coaching opponent, Jimmy Johnson, leading the 97 Hurricanes in uniform tonight out onto the field. Let's listen. Buccaneers might not be watching with special interest as Vinny Testaverde plays his final college game tonight. Tampa Bay, of course, owning the NFL's number one draft choice, and they could use it to select Testaverde. In an 11-0 season, Miami truly was never threatened. Their closest game, week two, a 23-15 win over Florida, but that was at Florida, and it was the Gators' first home loss since 1982. And Joe Paterno brings the Nittany Lions up. Wear the blue and white tonight for the Nittany Lions in their 11-0 season, the closest they came to defeat, and it was a close call. In their ninth win of the year, they beat Maryland 17-15, and the Terrapins had a crack at a two-point conversion in the last minute, and they didn't get it. That could have tied the game up. Well, we're moments away from kickoff. That means it's time to turn things over to our game crew, headed by Charlie Jones, who's celebrating a milestone of his own tonight. This is the 20th bowl game Charlie has worked on network television. And Charles, I would guess, and it's a safe guess, this is the biggest of all. Let's go up to Charlie Jones.
This bowl game is entirely different than any other of the bowl games that I have covered. The reason? This is for a national championship. Usually a bowl game is a reward to the players. Have a good time, enjoy yourself, and then try and win the bowl game. But with a national title on the line this week, everybody's uptight. It's been more like a Super Bowl week. And joining me in the telecast, two men with Super Bowl experience. The first, Bob Greasy.
Charlie, the thing I remember most about the Super Bowl week is you got all kinds of time to prepare. We knew exactly what we wanted to do and when we wanted to do it. And we knew what they were going to do against us. The problem being so confident, I remember on the way to the stadium, I fell asleep in the back of the bus.
Jimmy Cephalo, did you fall asleep during Super Bowl week?
I slept through a couple of the games. It's probably why we lost both of the Super Bowls that I played in. What I remember most is the tremendous hype. There's a lot of pressure on the players from their fans, their friends, their relatives, and from the media as well. I once got a phone call from a grade school teacher that said, I gave you an A in math when you're 8 years old. You owe me 2 Super Bowl tickets. These players have gone through the same thing. They want to get on and play the football game.
Speaking of the game, Bob, how do you see it?
Well, Charlie, I see two different styles of offenses. One very conservative, Penn State with John Schaefer, a leader but not a great thrower. Vinny Testaverde, big plays. Miami can go out and score at any time. Schaefer could not make Miami's team. Testaverde would not have won the Heisman Trophy at Penn State.
Interesting statement. Speaking of Penn State, they're the underdog. Can they pull off the upset?
Well, I think they can, but they've got to defend Testaverde, obviously. They do it with 22 players. Obviously, the 11 on defense, but also the 11 on offense have to keep Testaverde on the sideline where he's safe by controlling the football as much as possible.
It's the national championship. We'll be back with a kickoff in just a moment. For the quarterback for Penn State, and the two deep backs will be Jim Coates, number 49, and Blair Thomas, number 32. The University of Miami ranked number 1 in the country. Penn State University ranked number 2. The two head coaches.
Behind it.
And the moment is at hand. The national championship rests in the balance. Out to the 20. An ex- Redux, the return man, just past the 30-yard line where Bobby Harden makes the tackle, 17 yards on the return, and the Penn State Nittany Lions, led by their quarterback John Schaefer, an academic All-America, with D.J. Dozier and Tim Manoa, Eric Hamilton, Ray Roundtree, and Brian Seiberling, the tight end. Conlon, Morgan, Radisek, Wisniewski, and Clayton, the offensive line. First down for Penn State at their own 31-yard line. Play action. Almost sacked and then dumped. Dan Filio. And Dan Stubb. A loss of 15 yards and the Nittany Lions in trouble from the beginning.
Charlie, Penn State wanted to change things up at the beginning, so they're going to try and throw the football, but it is Stubbs from the outside coming in to make the sack. They didn't catch the Hurricanes off at all. That's number 99, Moss, getting that first, and Stubbs taking care of it later on. Dan Cilio, a big, strong defensive tackle in the middle, had part of it as well.
Second down and 24. And Dozier then coming out with the football. They're going to mark the ball dead at the 20-yard line. A gain of four. Going to be third down and 20. And
as they had coming into this football game, it obviously did not work on that first down play.
Awkward in motion. Schaefer with pressure again, and he is wrestled down for the second time in the ball game. This time it was Bill Hawkins who got it. So a pair of sacks open the ball game for the Hurricane defense. The tight end changes side. That's Charles Hinton. Testaverde takes a lot of time. He gives to Bratton. Bratton outside on the left sideline.
Elton Brepoff, the number 31.
And the three of White, Russo, and Johnson. The strength, of course, the linebacker. Graham Bauer, Giftopoulos, and All-American Shane Conlon. And problems in the secondary. Cobbs, Henderson, Isom, and Johnson. The problem is they're not that tall. It's a small secondary.
That's the biggest problem they have. Michael Irvin, 6'2", wide receiver from Miami, is going against a couple of defensive backs, 5'9", 5'9", 5'10", and 5'11".
And Testaverde's first pass is on target to Michael Irvin. And Irvin has the first down. As he goes out of bounds at the Penn State 47-yard line, he picks up 12 on the play.
So he's not going to take any chances. They're going to get Eddie Johnson on the corner some deep ball.
Last night, Irvin said he ran a late 4.49.
Yeah, he just didn't say how late it was.
First down. He is met by Bob White, number 34.
Brought down by number 34, Bob White.
Penn State stopped on their first thrust, and this opportunity as Testaverde rolls out and is tipped in the air and is incomplete. Highsmith, the intended receiver. And Bob White was the man putting the pressure on. So it'll be third down and eight for the kick. Highsmith, the remaining back. Testaverde over the middle to the tight end, Charles Henry. And Henry down at the 35-yard line, a gain of just over 10 yards and enough.
Keep switching their defensive linemen. They want a lot of fresh people in there because they know Testaverde has a great deal of mobility. They want to keep those people fresh so they can continually try to put some pressure on the Miami quarterback.
They're down and four. Testaverde rolling right. Lots of time. He throws deep into the end zone. And it is incomplete. Brett Perryman is trying to hang on to the ball and one foot in the end zone and he couldn't do it. Duffy Cobb had the coverage. Fourth and four, 9:39 is the time, first quarter. Testaverde over the middle, tipped, it's incomplete. Henry, the intended receiver, the tight end. The Nittany Lions hold. Man who was down as we pause briefly for station identification. This is the NBC television. For Penn State, two for Conlon. on the return. 5-yard line, first down. Goal to go with a national championship in the balance.
Remember when you were a kid growing up, you dreamt about things like maybe playing in a national championship football game. Fourth quarter, you're down by 3 points. You make a big interception. That's exactly what Shane Conlon did. And his dreams of his youth may come true tonight.
From the power up. A scramble for the ball. There was a misconnection on the snap. Talk it over. We'll be back in just a moment.
Back to that last interception. Conlon and another linebacker lined up here. The tight end's going to run straight up the field. Now watch as Conlon and the other linebacker go straight back. And Conlon says, "You're in my way. Scoot over there." And it's as if Testaverde saw the inside linebacker, but not Conlon. Tried to throw it over his head and was picked off by Conlon for the second time today.
And Trey Bauer, the inside linebacker, who then came up and was doing the congratulations. And the ball now at the 6-yard line after the miscue on the snap. Second down goal to go to the sideline. And Noah and Dozier, the running back. And it's Dozier. Dozier scores! And 13 seconds left in the ball game, and now the extra point attempt. Massimo Manco, and it is good. Penn State 14, Miami 10.
The replay for the score. Dozier takes it wide and cuts back between. Nice block by Keith Radisic, number 56, the center, in for the score and a Penn State lead.
And it is set up by the Penn State defense and is set up by a Penn State linebacker, Shane Conlon, with the interception. 6 yards on the 5 yards on the drive in two plays. And the score coming from 6 yards out, of course, the fumble, the loss of a yard. And it's 14-10, but a lot of time for the Canes. 8 minutes and 13 seconds, and they have the arm of Vinny Testaverde, and he has not been playing that well thus far. But can he do it? Here's another look at DJ Dozier. DJ, a very religious young man. In fact, when we were shooting the headshot to all the players on Sunday, he was with a group of five, the last ones to be shot because he came back from church.
And that's exactly, he wasn't tired at the end. He was kneeling down in prayer, and it's a ritual that he goes through after every touchdown.
Only the second man in Penn State history, as you saw, to rush for more than 3,000 yards. 9 seconds on the 25-second clock. It's there, first down. Brian Blades plays down the sideline all the way to the Penn State 41. Jimmy takes the timeout. The 11-yard line. There are 9 seconds remaining.
Field immediately.
The Penn State Nittany Lions are the national champions. John Schaefer's record as a starting quarterback since the seventh grade is now 66-1. And Joe Paterno has won his 199th game. You could talk about numbers for the next week, but there's only one to count, and that's number one.
It's an incredible football game by both teams, though. Storybook season for the University of Miami coming in at 11-0, registering the first undefeated season, the regular year on the part of the University of Miami. And now Penn State will undoubtedly be crowned the national champion.
Offensive guard for Penn State, Dan Morgan at 6'6", 272 pounds. Every time we saw him this week, he said, say something about the offensive line. Say something about the offensive line. They were magnificent. Penn State was magnificent. And I think the Canes were also. It's just the way that it ought to be. It came down to the last minute of play for the national title. And Vinny Testaverde back at fourth and sixth. And it could have been over several minutes ago.
But he showed a great deal of character as well, yeah. Bob, with fourth and six, as you mentioned, throwing the football out to his blades and then getting the first down and giving his team an opportunity to win the football game. And that's what he had to do, Bob.
I think you have to give credit to Joe Paterno and his staff for doing an outstanding job of shutting down Testaverde and winning the national championship.
Let's go down to Ahmad Rashad. Ahmad?
We were cheering some. Saying you guys, you play, that's the way you win a national championship, right out there on the field.
Oh, exactly. They were talking about our defensive backs being too short. Man, they didn't want to catch the ball. They just came up and rocked them. That's the key to the game. They didn't want to catch the ball.
You guys wanted to go out and finish it, but it seems to me you kept them in third and long all the time. How'd you do that?
It's just a great effort by our front people. Just a great effort by the whole team. I mean, we knew we could beat them. We had in our minds if we beat them all around, and we just took off and did it.
All right, it's good. Coach Paterno, Coach. Congratulations, Coach. I just told Shane. Who are we here? All right, I just told Shane, this is the way you win a national championship out on the field.
Well, I always hoped you would that way. I think our kids played a great game. They beat a great football team tonight. I think our defense played about as great a college football game as I've ever seen.
They were so persistent. So persistent. They just destroyed the passing rhythm of mine.
Well, I think our defensive coaches did a super job getting the kids ready. And I came up with the big plays. They've done that now for 2 years. They're a great bunch of kids.
You've won a lot of big games, but this is the biggest one.
Well, it's one of the biggest ones, certainly. We've had a lot of luck in our life, and I've been fortunate to be around a lot of great young people and great coaches, and I just thank the good Lord for everything he's given me.
All right, congratulations, Coach. You guys are number one.
Well, I think so.
All right. Back up to Bob Costas.
Ahmad, thank you very much. As we pointed out at the very beginning of the game, a year ago at the Orange Bowl, it was there for Joe Paterno and the Nittany Lions against Oklahoma. The Sooners beat them, and they became the national champions. A second chance exactly a year later, and Penn State capitalizes, upsetting Miami, which had been a touchdown favorite. The Nittany Lions have a second national championship. You remember they got one a few years ago with a Sugar Bowl victory to climax a big season with a win over Georgia that gave them the national championship on that occasion. This is the 100th season of Penn State football, and they celebrate that century of excellence with a national title tonight. Vinny Testaverde unofficially threw for 285 yards, but of course he had the 5 interceptions among 7 Miami turnovers. What do they say about Schaefer? All he does is win. 66-1 since the 7th grade. Only the Orange Bowl loss last year against Oklahoma. Schaefer was just 5 of 16 for 53 yards, had one intercepted, but he comes out on the winning side. Penn State with the national championship, 14-10. We'll be back with more from Tempe, Arizona in just a moment.
For Penn State with 2 interceptions and 8 tackles. Alonzo Highsmith for Miami, 18 carries. He rushed for 119 yards, and each player will receive a special trophy in honor of his achievement in tonight's game. And Sunkist will donate $2,500 to the General Scholarship Fund of Penn State and Miami in their name. The final score, Penn State 14 and Miami 10, and I think it'll be said time and time again, the way to win the national championship is on the field like we have seen here.
Oh, I think so. I think this makes a big call to the NCAA for a national championship game to be played each and every year. They begin their convention this coming week in San Diego, and I think many people are saying, I hope they finally realize this is the way to win a national championship, by playing on the field.
Well, again, defense wins championships, and we saw it here tonight. Two good defenses, and you got to give your credit to Joe Paterno and his staff for coming in and stopping Vinny Testaverde in that offense, stopping him cold, 5 interceptions and 7 turnovers.
But I don't want the loss to be the end of the world for the Miami Canes. They had a great season. They had a tough time tonight against Penn State, and you know that ball club, and I understand they've got a couple of young quarterbacks that could be just as good as Vinny Testaverde.
Well, they are. They're a young ball club, and they'll be back, but I think what we talked about early, and that is Joe Paterno wanted to get inside of Testaverde's head. They were a little bit confused, get him rattled a little bit, and you had some problems, and it happened last year in the Sugar Bowl against Tennessee, and I think it happened here again this evening. Quarterback, when you're playing that style of defense, can't do it all himself.
What about Penn State? They just continue to do it.
Well, they do. Penn State had 17 fifth-year seniors, and to a man they said that we all decided to come back for our fifth year walking off the Orange Bowl field last year after being beaten by Oklahoma. They felt to a man that they could win a national championship, and they saw the dream come true tonight.
It has been the Sunkissed Fiesta Bowl, the final once again. It is Penn State, the national champion, defeating Miami by a score of 14-10. For Bob Greasy, Jimmy Cepelo, I'm Charlie Jones. Let's go to Bob Costas. Bob?
And all that remains now, Charlie, is to say goodnight. A national championship
member is over now in college.
And that championship belongs
to
Penn State, the Nittany Lions, John Schaefer, heading off following a 14-10 victory. These are unofficial numbers, but in terms of total offense, Miami had 445 yards to just 152 for Penn State.
A season to remember is over now in college football. Thousands of games played, a few individuals honored, a new national champion crowned. But the curtain also comes down in a different sense tonight. We focus on the headliners and the pro prospects, and we forget that for many of these participants, it's the end of football. The end of an essentially youthful experience. They move on now to careers and responsibilities. Time passes, but the memories last.
This is the time! Those it will not last forever. These are the days to hold on to. Those we won't hold, we won't want to. This is the time, the time is gonna change. I know we gotta lose somehow, but I don't wanna lose you now. This is the time to remember, 'cause it will not last forever. These are the days to hold on to, 'cause we won't call it where we want to. This is the time, the time is gonna change. You've given me the best of you, but I need the rest of you.
And even after the bitter taste of this defeat fades away for Jimmy Johnson and for Vinny Testaverde, we hope they too will have fond memories of the experience of this college football season, a season which ends without a national title for them and with the national championship for Joe Paterno and the Nittany Lions of Penn State. We'll see you tomorrow at 12 Eastern Time with NFL 86 before the Browns-Jets game. So long from the Fiesta Bowl.
Emotional fears, but
the national championship lives up to its billing.
Congratulations, guys. You did it.
Schaefer's record is a starting.
It's Penn State pandemonium tonight in Tempe, Arizona. College football's game of the year is now history, and the Nittany Lions are number one. I'm Diane Allen. It lived up to its billing and more. College football's game of the year, a Fiesta Bowl clash between the nation's two top teams. And when the dust finally settled in Sun Devil Stadium tonight, Penn State edged out Miami for the national championship 14-10. Now this was the play that put State in the lead for good. Shane Conlon with a crucial fourth quarter interception. And that was one of five interceptions thrown by Miami quarterback Vinny Testaverde, the Heisman winner. Yes. And minutes later, DJ Dozier scores what proved to be the winning touchdown. Now, right now, Channel 3 sports director Lou Tilley standing by live at the scene of the big game, Sun Devil Stadium in Tempe, Arizona. Hi, Lou. Hi, Jackie.
Wow, what a game. Absolutely incredible.
You know, it had a lot of the great elements, not some of the not-so-great elements with the turnovers, but the end was just spectacular, and the true story was the Penn State defense, first and goal, Miami at the nine, and they come up big again, and Testaverde just falls apart. It's unbelievable.
Last try for Miami down at that end, I thought, oh, yeah. Geez, they may have it. They may have it. The defense pulled him out again. Well, interception.
You know, Vinny was spectacular in the last drive. He completed a 7-9 to get down there. But then they had to get it in, and that was the key. Paterno challenged him to do it all day, and they couldn't. And Paterno defense, and I got to say, Jackie, character. Character was the difference in this football game.
You know, we were talking about how the fans here for Penn State must have outnumbered Miami at least 8-1. It was definitely a Penn State.
Oh, a huge victory for the fans. And they're enjoying it still behind us there. If you can just see off to the left behind us, Jackie, they're still going after it pretty good out there.
That's right. And earlier tonight, Channel 3's Walt Hunter was out in the crowd and was able to file this report.
Some of the loudest and most loyal voices cheering for the Penn State team tonight were none other than Delaware Valley residents.
Hey, Philadelphia, go State!
Go State all the way! You bet you!
And these folks from Hatfield even brought along Godzilla, perhaps to scare the opposition.
A lot of people don't know Godzilla was a Penn State grad.
Penn State's band fired up the crowd with a big boost from two Delaware Valley musicians.
Why, this is great. We're going to win. We're number one. We're going to win. Yeah, we're going to win.
And while the fans put their best faces forward, it was still a nightmare of a crowd to wade through if you were selling soft drinks.
Is it very crowded up there?
72,000 people. You ask me if it's crowded? Come on, give me a break.
And for the handful of people who came here and were too lazy to clap, presenting the instant clapper. It's automatic. You don't even have to move your hands. Whether you wave your pom-poms for Penn State or yell for Miami, no matter how you looked at it, it was quite a game. In Tempe, Arizona, Walt Hunter, Channel 3 Eyewitness News Nightcast.
Well, there's the scene again, Jack. It's still going on, huh?
That's right. A lot of folks on the field. The security people here had a rough time. The Penn State folks are like antelope jumping that barrier, getting onto the field.
That's good. Antelope, yeah. Not animals.
Learned that
because
part of the field.
It really wasn't a rally crowd. It was a spirited crowd. And here's the guy that called it right on the money tonight. Tom Brookshire, you said Dozier on the grass, and how will Miami react to pressure?
Well, I think Testaverde proven that he's one of the great quarterbacks that there is. That last drive was about as good a drive as I've ever seen, but the Penn State defense was a lot better than I expected to be. They were really fantastic.
His favorite receiver was Shane Conlon tonight.
You know, how about six turnovers? And, you know, Miami was the number one team in the country on that plus turnover minus takeaway thing.
I mentioned it, Tom. You know, you did too. You said that Miami had never been challenged in the pregame show that we did. And sure enough, except for the last drive, they didn't react to pressure. They turned it over four of the last six times they had the ball.
Yeah, and they do have a lot of quality players, but Highsmith looks like he's going to be a number one running back, doesn't he, in the NFL?
Man. A couple of Penn State DBs still wearing his bruise on their foreheads.
It's got to be Paterno's greatest win, though. I would bet he will say that.
Greatest moment? Do you think it'd be a factor in any future considerations for his future? I mean, he's talked about retiring at times the last couple of years.
Yeah, I know, but that's a young team. I don't think he can leave that program.
Hey, you know, you talked with the Schaefers at great length, Jackie, and I know for you, you got attached a little bit to that family and the abuse they took in the last year, and this must have been a big win for them.
It was very tough. John Schaefer's mother especially was saying because of what happened last year in the Orange Bowl, John was taking it all very personally, and that for them, that they were trying to protect him from the media, to keep him away from folks, and he's got to be one happy young man.
He still had the smoothest thing I've ever seen. You know, when he rolled out for that touchdown, it's later he waited for Paterno to say, go ahead and run it in.
I know.
Okay.
Absolutely incredible. One other note, this has been the largest spectator-watched event here in Arizona history.
Yeah.
And I know that there are a lot of Penn State fans back in the Delaware Valley who've been watching this game, and I think Channel 3's Jack Jones is with that crowd.
All right. Jackie, people in Philadelphia, Penn State alumni, aren't really excited about all this. Actually, Jackie, it's been New Year's Eve all over again. I'm in a room with about 70 Penn State alums. They have, for one thing, they have painted their fingernails. Penn State, as you can see, they have a huge rear number one Nittany Lion cake, all done up in the blue and white. And gang, I have a question for you. Was there ever any doubt? So here we are once again, New Year's Eve, a wonderful time, and they're celebrating. What else could I say? Back to you, Mr.
Everybody was celebrating here too, Jack.
That's absolutely
true. Yells went up here in the
studio. Place was going crazy, yeah. Just like the fans. Well, the weather, switching gears a little bit, the weather, another story. Oh, my heavens, it was, you probably doing the same thing.
I know I was. Those last 25 seconds
something
of the
else.
Game.
It was being billed as the good guys against the bad guys, and the good guys in the majority white helmets got the win. Well, the Nittany Lions are the national champions of college football. A tight ball game tonight, plagued by turnovers, was the story. But in the end, PSU overcame it all and got the win. Stop the action in the second quarter. Miami came out like they were still wearing those battle fatigues. They went to war. Jerome Carter sacks John Schaefer. Turnover. Miami recovered, and the Canes were fired up early. Miami took over and ended their drive right here. The handoff goes to Melvin Broughton, and Broughton flies over the top for the touch. Miami had the early 7-0 lead. The Lions charged back hard. They put together a 12-play drive, and it was kept right here. John Schaefer with the football. He rolled right. No receiver, so he's going to keep it. He got a good block and just made the corner of the end zone for the touch. Tied at 7 at the half. In the fourth quarter, the Hurricanes were deep in their own territory with a 10-7 lead. Just already back to passing. Needs a big play, but he got it for Penn State. Conlon picked it off. He had two interceptions. He wants the end zone here, but he stopped short. The momentum had switched in favor of the Nittany Lions. The icing on the cake was provided shortly thereafter when DJ Dozier got the call, and Dozier went up the middle behind some great blocks, and it was 14-10 in favor of Penn State. And Coach Joe, well, they were heading for the national title. Miami put together a late-game drive, and Vinny Testaverde was the man in the spotlight. He had four interceptions going into the closing seconds. Make it five. The pass was picked off by Pete Giftopoulos, and that was the ball game. Penn State and head coach Joe Paterno win the national title. They beat Miami, the final score, 14-10 in favor of Penn State, 9 turnovers, 6 by Miami. We hope you enjoyed our local and national Fiesta Bowl coverage. Let's go back to Tempe, where Lou Tilley is standing by. And Lou, as I mentioned, lots of turnovers tonight. But overall, I thought both clubs went at each other pretty hard.
That's putting it lightly. There's going to be a lot of bumps and bruises tomorrow for both clubs, but Penn State's going to wake up with smiles on their face. You can bet that. And take a look at this scene, UK Washington. Joe Paterno nailing down his second national championship in 5 years, being carried off the field by his players. And just listen to the sounds, including Eddie Johnson, local guy from Lindenwald, New Jersey, and John Schaefer, as they reacted to the Fiesta Bowl and the national championship. Listen.
I can't explain how I feel. Crazy job. Crazy job.
Well, look at this now. Back here live, Tom Brookshire, Chris Conlon, Delaware Valley product, offensive tackle. Oh, my goodness. What a game, huh?
It was unbelievable. Our defense played outstanding. When we come into the game, we thought we were going to win, and we did.
Yeah, the big play now, Tom, down on the goal line here. I guess it was, what, second and goal from about the
8-yard line?
And they busted off that big right side. What'd you do there?
I down blocked on Osorio, number 93, and like kind of drove him into the ground, and Morgan pulled right behind me and kicked out the end, and DJ got in.
Hey, looking at some of the defensive plays
Tom. You really showed me something. I didn't know he had that much lateral movement. He was absolutely great tonight.
Yeah, DJ's quick. Those black shoes, throw a little bit out.
Were they tougher defensively than maybe you thought they were going to be, Chris?
Looking at the film, we knew that we were going to be tough and quick coming up the ball and everything.
What are you thinking right here? Vinny had the last chance to score and your defense is back there.
I couldn't believe it. They were down here like on the 30 or something. He was driving them down. So I was like, oh no, Vinny's going to do it again.
Would you ever believe you could get 6 takeaways against that offensive end? I couldn't believe it either.
I couldn't believe it either. Our defense, like I said, defense is great.
What did Joe say? I mean, you were having some trouble in the first half handling that big guy, Jerome. He's running all over the place. And at halftime, he said, we got to do something to handle that guy.
Yeah. Well, we kind of came out and single blocked him. But after a while, we started double teaming him. And then he didn't get too much into the backfield.
What's going on back in that locker room right now?
It's unbelievable. People are going nuts, taking pictures and everything. But that hasn't sunk in on me yet.
Hey, we appreciate it. Thanks for coming out. Enjoy.
Congratulations, Chris. course, in the Delaware Valley. And Tommy Brookshire, again, to recap before the game.
Yes.
You thought they'd have the edge, and they sure did.
I thought both teams would score a little bit more than that, but it really doesn't make any difference. 4 points is 4 points.
Now, what everybody's going to talk about tomorrow, of course, is the interceptions.
That you picked Miami.
That's we're trying to forget about that. Well, you know, we said that, and I said that if Miami scored first, that Penn State would have problems. Well, they did, but they came back and won anybody. Anyway, and people are going to say, Vinny, did he choke Tom? I mean, is it that simple?
I don't think so. I think they gave him a lot of different sophisticated defenses. I've never seen linebackers get good drops like Conlon and the guys were doing tonight. They really did. They had great drops, and they gave him a lot of new stuff underneath.
A couple times when he threw it to Conlon out there in the flat, there wasn't even anybody from Miami. Would you think Penn State that well prepared? They were anticipating routes?
Yeah, I think so. And I think Paterno, with the extra week or so, can prepare for a big player like Testaverde, like he's done in the past. You know, he took away Marcus Allen, and he's taken away Herschel Walker, and he took away Testaverde tonight.
Ricky, it was a fun football season for you and I. We started kicked it off in the preseason with the Eagles, and here we wrap it up with a Butte.
I'm wondering if Buddy Ryan might go for Conlon as a linebacker instead of Bosworth.
Well, if there was any doubt that he's a high in the top five picks, I think Shane Conlon showed it tonight.
Yeah, I know it.
Ricky, I enjoyed it, all right?
Thank you.
I'm buying the Coronas. I got it wrong. Penn State on top. We'll see you back in Philly. That's the story, live. From Tempe, Arizona. Yuki?
All right, Lou, Tom, thanks for all the coverage this week. Hats off to all of you out there behind the scenes as well. And hurry home, you guys, to some real weather. Yes, indeed.
With Penn State proving it is the number one team in the country, a final look at Fiesta festivities from touchdown to touchdown.
Penn State, number one.
Yeah. That's this edition of Eyewitness News Nightcast. I'm Diane Allen.
And I'm Jerry Pennacoli. Join us tomorrow for the Mummers Parade coverage starting at 8 o'clock in the morning, right here on Channel 3.
We sure hope so. Now for Tom, Yuki, Lou, who's at the Fiesta Bowl, the entire Eyewitness News team, have a good night and a great tomorrow.
Good night now. Sleep well. Because of the Fiesta Bowl, we join Johnny Carson in progress right now.
Conlon again with the interception and down the sideline. On second down and goal, Penn State's massive right tackle, Chris Conlon, a Glenside PA, would blow open a massive hole. DJ Dozier, perhaps sensing the significance, giving thanks. But thanks better given to the Penn State defense, because in the game's final play, Testaverde still with the chance for the starring role. Paterno not quite ready to celebrate, with 9 seconds still on the clock.
Off the field!
So in the end, this is what it's all about. Joe Paterno with the craziest looking defense that I've ever seen, let alone Vinny Testaverde.
And the trophy, hello.
Number one, baby, number one.
I can't explain how I feel. Praise God. I'm happy right now.
Oh, Jesus,
how do you feel, Johnny?
Good. I feel tired. It's great for the time.
From Tempe, with the national champions, Lou Tilley, Channel 3 Eyewitness Sports.
And we'll have the complete success story on the number one college football team in the nation. Join us Monday night at 7 for Penn State Proud. It's a half-hour Eyewitness News special. We'll talk to Nittany Lions players and their families about the thrill of victory. And we'll have reaction from some of the thousands of fans who cheered their team to the national championship. That's Penn State Proud with Lou Tilley. Seven years is happening from every corner of the Delaware.
The Penn State Nittany Lions are the national champions. We'll be right back.
This is an Eyewitness News special. Penn State Proud. A look back at the national championship.
We sure are. Good evening, and welcome to this Eyewitness News special, Penn State Proud. I'm Lou Tilley.
And I'm Jackie Hayes. It was a dream come true for the Nittany Lions of Penn State. Last Friday, they became the national champions of college football.
You know, the odds makers said that Miami would win this game comfortably, but as we know now, the odds makers don't play the games, and Penn State proved them wrong. They beat the Hurricanes 14-10, and a tremendous upset and a tremendous game. And Jackie Hayes and I were there along with the crew all week long.
And tonight in this special, relive with us some of the very special moments of this big game. It is a game to remember.
You know, in the course of the week, we saw the excitement grow leading up to the game itself. And tonight in this Eyewitness News special, we'll take you back to Harrisburg, where hundreds of fans were on hand to welcome back to Pennsylvania, the number one team in college football. Now we'll take you back to Arizona, where Penn State fans spent a week preparing for the game and enjoying the Arizona sunshine. And of course, we'll also relive the exciting moments on the field for Penn State as they picked up the national championship, and we'll show you how the Nittany Lions did it. They won the national championship with the highlights, and we'll talk to the key players involved. And helping us out, of course, is our expert analyst, Tom Brookshire, who's standing by live with us in Denver. He was in Tempe with us and joins us tonight to look back on college football's game of the year. Thanks for joining us, Brookie, and we'll have him up next.
That's right. We first began with the homecoming for the Nittany Lions. They returned to Pennsylvania late yesterday, arriving in Harrisburg on a charter jet. Students and alumni were in hand to welcome the number one team in college football, and so was Channel 3's Barbara Monaco.
Thousands of Penn State fans chanted, "We're number one." They were ready to welcome the team that brought home the national championship. Fans held signs and banners praising the champions, and the crowd really didn't need cheerleaders to drum up enthusiasm. Fans came dressed for the part. Some wore Nittany Lion paw prints on their cheeks, this child and this one dressed in lion costumes, and blue and white were the colors of the day.
Penn State isn't just clowning around.
Came from how far?
60 miles.
60 miles?
Yes.
And tell me why.
Curiosity to see all the people out here.
Oh, it was fantastic. It was a heart-wrencher, though, the whole way through down to the last seconds. But it was a terrific game, and I'm glad we won. We're number one again.
Joe Paterno wasn't present, but the crowd roared nonetheless when the other coaches and defensive tackle Bob White came up on the stage carrying the team's trophies. Governor Thornburg offered congratulations with humor.
But the guys in the white hats, the white helmets, pulled it off and put the Hurricanes in a Miami vice.
Both the players and the coaches told the fans they couldn't have won without them.
I'm getting emotional, I know. When we came onto the football field, that was like Beaver Stadium. There were so many great Penn State fans. You don't know what an important part you play and what they played in football, in the football game, and the outcome.
The crowd had and a humble defensive tackle, Bob White, told me the offense deserved a lot more credit than it was getting.
I know everyone is saying the defense got it done, but you know the offense did a nice job too. After all, they did put 14 points on the board, and that was enough to win, and that's all that matters now.
The coaches and the team say a lot of the credit belongs to the Penn State fans. They say the fans deserve the national championship because they're number one fans. At the Penn State campus in Harrisburg, I'm Barbara Monaco, Channel 3 Eyewitness News.
You know, legend has it that Vinny Testaverde's father handed him a football on his fifth day on this earth and was preparing him for the Heisman Trophy ever since. Some people say that those four wasted days of preparation cost Miami the game. Now, this game was hyped by the media as the college football game of the year and maybe the century. In some ways, the game didn't live up quite to expectations. It was sloppy at times, with 11 turnovers and four other fumbles. But make no mistake about it, with a national championship on the line, there was some very hard hitting.
The very first series. Lyndon Wald's Eddie Johnson lets Miami's bomb squad know that indeed this would be a war. It had the desired effect. Miami's fleet platoon of receivers must have heard the rumblings of Penn State's artillery, for they dropped the ball like live grenades throughout the night. And still, Vinny Testaverde, the Hurricanes' five-star general, just kept searching and escaping an end zone sack here, and eventually rumbling forward for 26 yards. Meanwhile, Penn State's John Schaefer, for the most part, was stumbling. And when the ball bounced off his knee into Miami's arms, the first battle went to the Canes. When Melvin Bratton lifted himself over the wall and into the end zone, the first points went to Miami, supposedly the kiss of death for Penn State. What a shock then, when on third and long on the next series, Schaefer found Eric Hamilton with a long strike and then sent fullback Tim Manoa rumbling down near the Miami goal.
Good blocking on the part of the offensive line of Penn State, opening a wide...
And then reluctantly sent himself on a solo mission wide right, finally heading upfield for the score that would end the first half in a 7-7 tie. But with Miami clearly getting the better of things in every statistic but the score. But no matter, for Paterno had constructed an indestructible bubble around the vaunted Testaverde. Literally, with linebacker Shane Conlon floating, sometimes to blitz, sometimes double covering Michael Irvin, or here in a deep zone, he was clearly the master of a psychological battle that would turn Vinny Testaverde's dream season into a nightmare. The Lions failed to capitalize, and in fact they fell behind when Miami booted through the go-ahead field goal in the final period. But a pattern had been set. Four times in five possessions, the Hurricanes would turn the ball over. But only one mattered when Conlon, here number 31, directly in Testaverde's line of sight, almost the intended receiver as he made the interception, and then almost stepping out of bounds on the return near the 15, but setting up the winning touchdown. If Dozier were praying for thanks, he might have prayed for some more help. And so it all came down to one final play for the national championship.
I think we could have written a better script. Joining us now live from Denver, Colorado, our expert analyst, Tom Brookshire. And talk about a better script, Joe Paterno couldn't have written a better plan. Could he, Tommy?
I don't think so, Lou. How you doing, Jackie? The thing I keep thinking about is that this was a very special national championship, if you will, for Joe Paterno. He has one in the bag already when he beat Georgia, but he's 59 years of age, and he wants to go out as a pure champion as a coach, and he's always said he didn't want to wait too long, and that Bear Bryant may have gone 1 year too long. Some of the great legends in coaching or broadcasting or playing always stay too long, and I think Joe Paterno wanted this one more than any other national championship he could possibly ever have wanted, and we all go back to those three undefeated years back in the late 60s and the early 70s, 73. They won the Cotton Bowl, unbeaten and everything, and they still were not called the best in the country. So I think Paterno really simmered beneath this ball club the entire way. And I remember Tom Landry once said, adversity is only good if you overcome it. So I think if Penn State is a better team, a better university because of this, it's only because they went out and won, and they did it about the last play of the game.
Tom, we have a couple of particulars that we'll talk about in the course of our half-hour show, but right now we're going to move along. Janky?
And that's right. Coming up, we're going to take a look back on the week of excitement in Arizona, and you'll meet one of Joe Paterno's players who calls Philadelphia home. Stay with us.
If there's one thing I've tried to teach my linebackers over the years, it's don't get faked out. Hold your ground, keep your head up.
Joe Paterno, he never gets faked out when it comes to recruiting top-flight talent for Penn State. And Bell of Pennsylvania Yellow Pages is proud to have awarded 12 academic scholarships in the names of the team's most outstanding offensive players. And if you want to know how proud we are of the Nittany Lions tonight, I'll tell you. We're Penn State proud.
Presenting several fascinating home improvement ideas from your Honda dealers.
I'm Brian Dumble.
I'm Jane Paul.
I'm Pat Shirocki.
From world leaders and newsmakers to stars and celebrities, today talks to them all, weekday mornings at 7.
But first, for what's going on in your neighborhood and around the world, join me and 3 Today at 6:30.
For news, movies, fashions, turn to Today.
And 3 Today, we're there for you.
Good
Good evening and welcome back to our Eyewitness News special, Penn State Proud.
I think the title kind of says it all.
Does it?
You know, tonight you're going to meet a Penn State player who is oh so ever proud and who'll never forget this winning season. And Tom Brookshire will be back to join us again with his expert analysis on the game itself.
But first, joining us is colleague Walt Hunter. He was in Arizona with us all last week, helping to bring you the excitement that made the Fiesta Bowl. What a game. Well, it was fun.
Some weather, some game, Jackie. And by the time they got to Phoenix, the Penn State fans were ready to celebrate. If you think the game was memorable, well, the week of cheering and festivities that led up to the Fiesta Bowl was pretty remarkable also.
Almost from the moment their planes touched down on the runway at Phoenix, Penn State fans were ready to celebrate, with spirits soaring to an all-time high.
Who's going to win?
Penn State, of course. Penn State, actually, very much. All the way.
We love Joe Paterno, and we're taking it back this time.
It didn't take long before the beautiful red-tinted desert scenery of Phoenix began to assume a new color, the familiar blue and white of the Nittany Lions. The excitement grew still further with this Fiesta Bowl parade and other activities filling the streets of Phoenix. Then, inside the hotel, impromptu victory rallies with parents of players who came to watch their sons cheering harder than anyone.
We went to St. Patrick's Cathedral last week, my mother and I, we lit candles.
A lot of Hail Marys and our fathers.
These fans thought nothing of paying as much as $450 for these $25 tickets to the game. And souvenir shirts at $20 apiece were being picked off faster than one of Testaverde's passes. This pep rally, just hours before the game, gave fans a final chance to declare their love for their team. And maybe the fan with the biggest heart of all was 85-year-old Ray Willett, who travels thousands of miles from his Ocean City old age home just to watch State win.
I did not come here to see Penn State lose. That's my prediction.
You were right, Mr. Willett, but just how exciting that game would turn out would be hard to imagine for even the most dedicated Penn State fan.
And in addition to being very exciting, of course, all those fans were perfectly well behaved. It was a great party, and Jackie, I think everybody had a great time.
A lot of fun. A lot of good people.
Very nice.
Thank you.
Wow, happy people, I'll tell you that much.
You know, a chance to be associated with a national title was special for those Penn State faithful, and the shot at being number one was all important to the players, maybe one in particular. For several seasons now, Penn State's fans and coaches, along with us, have been waiting for DJ Dozier to really show his stuff. And he had a great freshman year, I recall. When he came to Penn State, they were calling him the next Kurt Warner, and that's high on a lofty level to live up to. Well, on the Fiesta Bowl night last night, he looked every bit as good, and you can see why right here, bursting up the middle and eventually way down inside Miami territory. DJ Dozier rushed for 99 yards on 16 carries, and here bursting off tackle and into the end zone. Behind the blocker, by the way, of Chris Kylan from Glenside, PA, the big tackle who we talked to the other night, DJ Dozier with a winning touchdown, and I think there is a shot that we will all remember so very well. And then, of course, on the other side of the ball, there was Alonzo Highsmith, who was just outstanding. Now, Tommy Brookshire told us before he expected these two guys to maybe be the top two players in the college draft as far as running back goes. And joining us now on Penn State Proud, maybe a future first-round draft pick, sophomore running back Blair Thomas from Philadelphia's own Frankfort High. He wears number 32. And Blair, you didn't get to play a heck of a lot in the Fiesta Bowl the other night. Did you see that coming with a big game on the line? Did you expect that Joe would go with a veteran and DJ Dozier?
Well, being a sophomore, I figured, you know, that they would play the older guys, get them a chance to show what they can do out there. So, you know, I wasn't too mad, at, you know, with that. So I just...
What's it like?
Enjoyed the game.
Yeah, what's it like on the sidelines? And remember, just a few years ago, you were in the shadow of Edmonds Elementary School over there at Frankfort Stadium playing for the Pioneers in Arangelo, and here you are on National Championship squad. What's it like?
Well, it's great just to be a part of the National Championship team. I'm glad we had the opportunity to go out to Arizona to display our ability out there against, you know, the great Miami team. So it's just wonderful just to be a part of the team and be from Philadelphia.
Let's go back to Denver now and Tom Brookshire. And Blair, I want you to introduce you to Tom Brookshire right here. And Brookie, this may be the next in the long line of tremendous Penn State tailbacks right here.
Well, I'm thinking about that number 32, Blair. If my memory doesn't fail me, and sometimes it has, Franco Harris wore that number at Penn State, so you're carrying a pretty good load around, a little tradition at the same time. You know, when I picked Penn State before the ball game, I picked them on the chance that they wouldn't get blown out early, they would stay close, and that because you guys had had some tough games during the year, maybe three or four where you had to come back in the last 4 or 5 minutes and win them, that if it got close late, that Penn State would win on perseverance. Did that play a part the other night, do you think?
I think the fact that we were in a lot of close games, that if we would have gotten to a close game with Miami, that we could have pulled it off. So, you know, I felt comfortable if it did come down to, you know, a close game like that, that we could pull it off.
Yeah, did you hope, too, that they wouldn't fall that far behind?
Yes, I did. I hope we didn't get too far behind, you know, because they do have a powerful offense, you know, that can put points on the board fast. So I'm glad we didn't get, you know, down early in the game.
Blair and Brookie, we will be right back after this. We're going to take a pause and a timeout right now. Language of Tom Brookshire and both you understand. This Eyewitness News special continues. Coming up, more excitement in college football's Game of the Year. Stay with us on Channel 3.
Discover the magic at the automotive event of the year. It's the 1987 Philadelphia International Auto Show, featuring over 500 cars and trucks from 9 countries, including Mr. T's A-Team van and the Jersey Devil Monster Truck. Meet Leader One Gobot, Kathy Lee Crosby, Andrea Evans, and beautiful Connie Selica at the largest and most spectacular ever Philadelphia International Auto Show, now through January 11th, Philadelphia Civic Center.
And welcome back to this Eyewitness News special, Penn State Proud.
In a moment, you'll hear from the winners and the losers, the players involved in Friday night's Fiesta Bowl. We'll have interviews from both the Penn State players and from the Hurricanes of Miami.
You know, Lou, I think the highlight for most of us out in Tempe last week had to be the last seconds of the game and the moments right after. It was chaos. It was people jumping over the fence onto the field. It was, as they say, being Penn State Proud.
Penn State fans flooded the field at Sun Devil Stadium to take their Nittany Lions into their arms to celebrate being number one. Even before the game was over, these Penn Staters with their waving blue and white pom-poms and outrageous costumes were confident that they'd beat Miami.
Hey, Philadelphia, go State! All right, we're going to do it!
We're going to win! Yeah, we're going to win. Go State all the way.
The Penn State Blue Band, led by drum major Greg Stockham for a win, rallied the crowd into a frenzy. Miami fans were badly outnumbered, and as it turned out, outmaneuvered, too.
I think there must have been 5,000 people out on that field.
Yeah, and a lot of happy ones, as a matter of fact.
Very happy.
But inside, they weren't all happy. As you might expect, when the game ended, there was a stark contrast in the two locker rooms. Well, in the Nittany Lion dressing room and outside, it was a lifetime dream come true.
Everybody in the country, it's not pretty, but we won, and we're number one in the country, and nobody can deny us now. Bottom line is, we won a football game. We're the best football team in this entire nation tonight, baby.
John Schaefer, who rebounded from that disappointing loss at the Orange Bowl, had a second chance at redemption and goes out a winner, because John Schaefer is probably not heading to the pros. But across the hall that evening in the Miami dressing room, they were trying to sort it all out. They had come into the game as favorites. They fully expected to win and win big. And the guy who is headed to the pros and counting on most to bring it all home was probably the most disappointed.
We've seen it a couple of times, and we've done well against it. Our running game was working good tonight, but we just couldn't put drives together and put it in the end zone. We had, you know, penalties, turnovers, fumbles, interceptions, you know, things like that hurt you. They did a lot of good things on defense, obviously. You know, I guess their main objective was to stop the pass. I believe they had 5 interceptions, and they played great ball tonight. Everybody knows it's a disappointment for me and the rest of my team. It's a tough one to swallow for all of us. We worked real hard for it, and we came up one short. Penn State has a great football team, and, you know, I guess they deserve to win.
The Hurricanes plane pulling into Miami Airport yesterday, bringing back a disappointed bunch of Miami Hurricanes who had missed their shot at a national title for the second consecutive year.
I don't feel any remorse about
what happened. Like I said, the only thing I feel bad about is that the seniors had to leave with that bitter taste in their mouth, and that, you know, with the Dolphins doing so bad, we couldn't bring home a championship for Miami, for the community.
It'll probably be painful for a long time, I think. Knowing that our defense played a hell of a football game, and that's the only thing I knew we had control over it. Pretty hard to look at the statistics and know that, you know, we really did beat them, but, you know, you got to give Penn State credit. They won.
You know, after I get over being disappointed in myself, I just really feel sorry for some of the people that I played with for 5 years who worked so hard this year to get things done. And, you know, as far as the offensive line that I've been here with, some for five and some for four, it's just, you know, it's something that hurts. But then you look back at the year and see how successful we were. And, you know, it's going to take time. But, you know, it'll heal.
I don't know about that. Joining us now live, my colleague at Channel 3 Sports, Yuki Washington, who was stuck in the studio all week, but spent a week before that in Miami, kind of getting close to the Hurricanes program. Now, I was going to ask you if you had crow for dinner, but if you did, it would be dinner for two.
Dinner for two. We both kind of picked Miami. I picked Miami as my sentimental favorite, as I said, during our hour special, because I knew two of the players from Miami working down in South Florida before coming here, and Warren Williams and Don Ellis. But sentimental favorites really don't cut it. We saw a great game. I was probably as hoarse as John Schaefer in that interview after the game. We saw an exciting game. And, you know, Miami was number one, and Penn State was number two. But, you know, you and I both know when it comes to sports, anybody can be beaten on any given night. And we saw that Penn State pride really come out in this football game up there in Tempe, Arizona.
And Tom Brusher, if he's still with us, when you added this thing up on paper, to some degree, it looked like a Miami win. But as we learn in this game, when we're playing, especially in the college ranks, Tom, 18, 19, 20-year-olds, you don't play it on paper.
Well, and you know, a test of Eddie really impressed me. Sometimes the best way to judge a future great pro is to see him when they're really having a tough time. And he had the five interceptions. He usually was on a one interception every 30 attempt. The Penn Staters got five in one game. They were the best team in turnover takeaway, and they gave up seven of them, and Penn State stole the game. But Penn State was the best tackling college football team the other night I've ever seen. Johnson in the secondary, all those kids, but the linebackers, Conlon, all of them, but they're the best tackling as a unit bunch in college that I've ever seen.
So Buddy Ryan keeps reminding us of, there's more to come now as our Eyewitness News special continues.
And we'll be right back.
I was heading for work at Bell of Pennsylvania Yellow Pages when...
Joseph!
Yes, ma'am.
How many kinds of Yellow Pages do you people think I need?
Just one, ma'am.
So what are these?
Well, they're not the genuine Yellow Pages from Bella, Pennsylvania.
Ah, the one I've been shopping with for years.
Yes, ma'am.
First place I look for everything I need.
Yes, ma'am.
And I'll stick with my Yellow Pages and they can...
Yes, ma'am.
Don't be fooled. Use the genuine Yellow Pages from Bella, Pennsylvania. We wrote the book.
And welcome back to our Penn State Proud Special. Penn State, the 1987 Fiesta Bowl, enter the sports history book.
Yeah, they do. They enter it as number one for the second time in just 5 years. You know, they won the Super Bowl, if you will, of college football. And Penn State beat the odds. In doing so, gained new respect, as if they needed it, and admiration from sports fans all around the nation.
We and our colleagues are pleased that we were able to bring you this spectacular sporting event, along with all the excitement and pageantry that went along with it.
And now it is time for all of us to give a final salute to the Penn State Nittany Lions. I'm Lou Tilley, along with Jackie Hayes, Tom Brookshire, Yuki Washington, thanking Blair Thomas for joining us. Thanks. Penn State proud, and let's hope we can do it again next year.
Thanks for joining us. Have a good night.